Hello and welcome to Good Gifts City Church weekly online service. We are celebrating communion right after worship, so please ready the elements of bread and wine for that. Let us now prepare our hearts and minds for this time of word and worship. Let us pray. Father God, thank you for seeing us through the week. Whether we are aware or not, we are grateful that you have been there with us. As we prepare to worship you, we ask that you shine your light on areas where we have fallen short. Search our hearts and bring to mind areas where we've been prideful and areas where we have yet to submit to your Lordship. We repent and ask that you forgive us. We thank you for your grace and your loving kindness, and we declare your Lordship over all aspects of our lives. We welcome you into our midst. Take pleasure in our songs now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Shout out your praise, there's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. message just search the world. It couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise treasures the faith, but never enough. You came along, put me back together.
Nothing is better. revive the dream that was dead. The things that we hoped for the last year that didn't come to pass, Lord, we ask you to do it again. Put our faith in you, our trust in you, knowing you are our sole provider. Hallelujah, Lord. Come and do it again.
I've seen you move. You move the mountains.
Family, thank you for friends. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. So much to give thanks for. Yes, Lord. I just want to sing a blessing over you this new year. The Lord bless you. Favor and his healing is upon you this very moment. He will restore the soundness of your mind, which was taken from you. Receive it in Jesus' name. Can we say amen? Come on. Say, may His favor.
May His favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you. And your family, and your children, and your children, and your children. May His presence go before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around you, and within you. He is with you, He is with you. In the morning, in the evening, in your coming, and your going, in your weeping, and rejoicing. Shalom, everyone. Praise the Lord. We are celebrating Holy Communion this week. Are you excited? Now let's prepare ourselves by having the elements, that is the bread and the wine, ready with you. Now before we partake the elements, let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you this evening with a heart of thanksgiving for what our Lord Jesus Christ had done at Calvary. You have reminded us to remember your death on the cross at Calvary each time we partake the elements during Holy Communion. As your word at 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 and 26 to 26 says, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come." Amen. Now, you are welcome to join us at the Lord's table if you are a baptized believer of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let's declare together. Now, let's look at the screen. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, according to your word, Jesus' body was broken for us. We acknowledge that he bore our sin, our sickness, our sorrow, our grief, our fear, and our torment. Through his body, we have complete redemption, total deliverance from the works of Satan
As new creation, we are free, redeemed, and forgiven in Jesus' name. As we partake of this bread, your broken body, we receive our wholeness. Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, we examine ourselves. We judge ourselves according to the authority of your word. In areas where we have missed the mark, covetousness, fear, worry, and unbelief, we take Jesus as our advocate and high priest. We ask for forgiveness according to the word of God. Your word says, you are faithful and just to forgive us when we confess our sins, and that you will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Father, we give you thanks for all you have provided for us in Christ Jesus. We declare this day that we are abundantly blessed. We are highly favored, and we are exceedingly loved. This covenant we entered into is a covenant filled with exceedingly great and precious promises of God, and we are partakers of those promises now. We are healed. We are redeemed. We are delivered from the power of darkness. We are the head and not the tail. We are above and not beneath. All that we set our hands to do, we will prosper in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's take our elements now. Let's together hold our bread up. Now this bread represents the crucified body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'd like you to visualize the excruciating pain and suffering Jesus suffered at the cross at Calvary. Lord, as we take the bread, we remember that you are the bread of life. You feed our souls, you nourish our hearts, and you give us strength to face the challenges of life. Above all, we thank you for dying at the cross at Calvary to be our Savior, our Lord and Master. We thank you that through your death, we can receive our healing too. We thank God that we can claim healing as we partake of the bread, because Jesus took away our infirmities and bore our sicknesses and diseases upon his body. And through his stripes, we are healed. Let's claim our healing as you take the bread, believing that healing is available right now. Let's take the bread together. Amen. Next, let's take our cup, raise our cup up. The Bible tells us that this cup represents the blood of Jesus that was shed on the cross at Calvary. Now, I'd like you to visualize the blood oozing out from his head, his hands, legs, and his entire body. It was truly bloody, but the blood of Jesus cleanses us of all our sins. The Bible declares that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all our unrighteousness. Your word further adds that as far as the east is from the west, that far will he forgive our trespasses. Let's partake together. Thank you, Lord, for the forgiveness of our sins as we repent and confess our sins. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Now let's continue to thank the Lord for His provision of salvation, forgiveness, and healing. We are eternally grateful for His amazing love and grace, which Father God so graciously given to all of us. Let's together in unison say, Amen. The Lord bless you.
Your blood shed for me, my whole eternity. Your grace shown to me gives me life, and now I see Your broken body is my healing. Your sinless blood gives my redemption. Your chosen suffering brings perfect life to me. Lord, Your sacrifice has made me whole. Through the cross I am forever put on me with the oil of Your Spirit, the anointing breaking fear. I'm alive, I am free. Yeah. Your broken body is my has made me whole. Through the cross I am forever Yours. This is a holy moment with You. I open my heart to all You want to do, and I still my soul to remember the cross, where You took all my shame and restored all I lost. This is a holy moment with You. I open my heart to all You want to do. I still my soul to remember the cross, shame and restored all I lost. When You took all my shame and restored all I lost. Yeah. Your broken body is my healing. Your sinless blood gives my redemption. Your chosen suffering brings perfect life to me. Lord, Your sacrifice has made me whole. Through the cross I am forever Yours. This is a holy moment with You. I open my heart to all You want to do. Took all my shame and restored all I lost. When You took all my shame and restored all I lost.
Thank you, Brother Lawrence, for leading us into remembering our communion with Christ. Incidentally, besides those of us you see on screen, the online service is put together by a small team of people working behind the scenes to plan, produce, and edit what you see on YouTube and Facebook every week. Let's take this opportunity to show our gratitude for their time and commitment over the last 2 years with a comment or emoji. Next, for those of you who require prayer or ministry, please send us a WhatsApp message at 8014-2599 with your full name and prayer requests. Please message us before 5 p.m. and our ministry team will be in touch with you right after the service. Today, Pastor Derek takes back the pulpit with a new series on the sin of pride. I am excited to hear what he has to share. But before he takes the stage, let us prepare our hearts with this song.
Hi everybody, it's great to be able to minister online, and also today we're actually on site as well. So we're kind of going hybrid, but for those of you who are not able to come to the meeting place, or those of you who are overseas, we trust that even as you listen to the Word of God, there will be a powerful work of the Holy Spirit in your lives. Let's commit this time to the Lord. Okay, let's pray together. Let's open our hearts to His Word, to His voice, in Jesus' name. Father, thank You that You are with us. Thank You, Lord, that time and space does not restrain, cannot hold back Your truth. So we just want to dedicate this time to You. May Your Word go forth and not return to You void as according to Your promise, but to accomplish that to which it has been sent. Strengthen us as we share together today. In Jesus' name, everybody say Amen. Let's read together from James chapter 4, verses 1 to 10. Okay, read aloud together with me. What is causing the quarrels and fights among you? Don't they come from the evil desires at war within you? You want what you don't have, so you scheme and kill to get it. You are jealous of what others have, but you can't get it, so you fight and wage war to take it away from them. Yet you don't have what you want because you don't ask God for it. And even when you ask, you don't get it because your motives are all wrong. You want only what will give you pleasure. You adulterers, don't you realize that friendship with the world makes you an enemy of God? I say it again. If you want to be a friend of the world, you make yourself an enemy of God. Do you think the scriptures have no meaning? They say that God is passionate that the spirit He has placed within us should be faithful to Him. And He gives grace generously. As the scriptures say, God opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble. So humble yourselves before God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come close to God, and God will come close to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, for your loyalty is divided between God and the world. Let there be tears for what you have done. Let there be sorrow and deep grief. Let there be sadness instead of laughter, and gloom instead of joy. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and He will lift you up in honor. In the English language, there are two uses of the word pride. The first is when we speak about being proud of our children, our friends, our church, our country, etc. So this is a form of affirmation, and it can be healthy as long as we also acknowledge that friends, church, and country have shortcomings, even serious ones. The other use of the word pride has to do with an undue sense of our own superiority and importance. This is often coupled with an unwillingness to see ourselves as we really are and refusing to acknowledge our weaknesses. Now, synonyms include smugness, arrogance, conceit, egotism. This is the kind of pride God wants us to know about. So I'm launching a 3-sermon series on the sin of pride. Today is part one, and I've entitled it The Seriousness of Pride. The Seriousness of Pride. C.S. Lewis, a very well-known English literature professor of years gone by, wrote this. He says, "Where there are two things inside me competing with the human self, which I must try to become. They are the animal self and the diabolical self. And the diabolical self is the worst of the two. That is why a self-righteous prick who goes regularly to church may be far nearer to hell than a prostitute. Of course, it is better to be neither." The book of Job in chapter 35 and verse 12 says, "And when they cry out, God does not answer because of their pride." And in Proverbs chapter 6, 16 to 19, "There are six things which the Lord hates. Yes, 7, which are an abomination to him, haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that run rapidly to evil, a false witness who utters lies, and one who spreads strife among brothers. God hates pride. And why is God so against pride? Let me share three reasons. Okay, the first is that it's devilish. Everybody say, pride is devilish. In Isaiah chapter 14, verses 3 to 4, read together. And it will be in the day when the Lord gives you rest from your pain and turmoil and harsh service in which you have been enslaved, that you will take up this taunt against the king of Babylon and said, how the oppressor has ceased and how fury has ceased. And then in verses 12 to 14 in the same chapter of Isaiah, how are you fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How you are cut down to the ground, you who weakened the nations. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God, I will also sit on the mount of the congregation, on the farther sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. You know, these the two passages of the Bible are a taunt and a rebuke against Babylon, the evil empire that destroyed Jerusalem. The name Lucifer was given to its king to denote his glory. The name Lucifer comes from the Latin version of the Bible called the Vulgate. I don't know whether many of you are aware that there is actually a Latin version. However, the original Hebrew word is Hallel, which means light, light bringer or shining one. In Latin, light is luc or lux, and bring is fer. So you combine those two syllables, you get Lucifer. Interestingly, this was also the Latin name for the planet Venus, the brightest object in the sky apart from the sun and the moon, appearing sometimes in the evening and sometimes in the morning as a star. God applied this to the king of Babylon, who in his glory and pomp had set himself among the gods. The name is appropriate, as the civilization of Babylon began in the grey dawn of history and was deep into astrology. Some scholars have also considered that the phrase son of the morning might even refer to the crescent moon. You know, there are spirits behind tyrants and dictators. Many of them are involved in occult practices of one form or another. They have among their counselors wizards, astrologers, and witch doctors. The Bible is full of them. Remember, Pharaoh of Egypt, Sennacherib of Assyria, Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, and the Caesars of Rome. In the so-called modern era today, many political leaders look to fortune tellers, monks, and sorcerers for guidance. These people understand that power is spiritual. Now, political power, any form of power, is spiritual. The Bible declares that Satan is the author and source of pride. In this allegorical passage of scripture, Satan boasts. He boasted. His entire emphasis is on what he thinks he can do. His last claim is most revealing. He believes he has the ability to become like God. Look at verses 13 to 14 again, right? How many eyes are there in these two verses? Do a quick count and put your answer in the comment box. How many eyes? Have you counted? How many are there? Okay, it's 5, right? Satan scorned dependence upon God and chose his own way. Throughout history, these self-exalting thoughts have echoed again and again in human hearts. All of us have sometime or other repeated them. We continue to believe that we can live without God, and even that we can be God ourselves. So that's the first thing about pride. Yeah, it's devilish. Secondly, it's deceitful. Everybody say, pride is deceitful. Read together. Obadiah, verse 3. You have been deceived by your own pride because you live in a rock fortress and make your home high in the mountains. Who can ever reach us way up here? You ask boastfully. A Christian businessman by the name of Howard Butt wrote an article entitled The Art of Being a Big Shot. The Art of Being a Big Shot. And he wrote this. It is my pride that makes me independent of God. It's appealing to me to feel that I am the master of my fate and that I run my own life, call my own shots, and go it alone. But yet, I get help from other people, and I can't ultimately rely on myself. I'm dependent on God, even for my next breath. So it's dishonest of me to pretend that I'm anything but a man, small, weak, and limited. So living independent of God is self-delusion. Pride is not just an unfortunate little trait, you know, by which we excuse ourselves, or humility, an attractive little virtue. It has to do with my inner psychological integrity that's at stake. When I'm conceited, I'm lying to myself about what I am. I'm pretending to be God and not man. My pride is the idolatrous worship of self, and that is the national religion of hell. How many of us have ever admitted to being proud? In fact, the few who do admit are already people who are well known to be very arrogant. Have you met people who are proud of being proud? Unfortunately, I have. Yeah, they actually declare they don't need people. They don't need others. Charles Colson wrote a book entitled Born Again. And he talked about President Nixon. Some of you will remember, there was something called Watergate, yeah, many years ago. And President Nixon was impeached because, well, he was resorting to some dirty methods to win his election. And he said that, Charles Colson said that President Nixon's biggest problem was that he could never admit he was wrong about anything. In fact, Colson says that even when Nixon had a cold, nose running, face red, sneezing, all the symptoms, he would never admit it. Wow, that is arrogance at its highest. So that's the second thing about pride. It's deceptive. We lie to ourselves. We deny stuff. Then the third thing about pride and why God has to surface and teach us about it and have to deal with it in our lives is that it is destructive. Say together, pride is destructive. In Proverbs chapter 26, verse 12, read with me. Do you see a man wise in his own eyes? There is more hope for a fool than for him. There is more hope for a fool than for him. Then Proverbs 16, verse 18. This is something that we should be familiar with. Pride goes before destruction, and haughtiness before a fall. You know, pride is the only disease that makes everyone sick except the one who has it. In James chapter 4, verse 6, God says He gave us more grace. That is why Scripture says God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So what God is saying here is that He purposefully, deliberately opposes proud people. Can you imagine that? You know, the worst state any person can find himself is when the Almighty God, Master of the Universe, sets Himself up against him. Would you like that? Would you like to have God deliberately, purposefully opposing you? C.S. Lewis wrote in his book, Mere Christianity, "It is pride that has been the chief cause of misery in every nation and family since the world began. Other vices may sometimes bring people together. And you may find good fellowship, joking, and friendliness among drunken people or even unchaste people. But pride always means enmity." Have you ever thought about that? Yeah, that when we have pride, we set ourselves up not just against God, but also to have enemies, to make enemies of people. And yeah, I have met people who are drunkards, who are on drugs, you know, sometimes even gangsters, yeah. They can have good friends, you know. But when pride comes in, yeah, they're out to destroy other people. Proverbs chapter 13 and verse 10. "Pride leads to conflict. Those who take advice are wise." Pride leads to conflict. Those who take advice are wise. There was a newspaper report, this goes back quite a long way, in the summer of 1986. Two ships collided in the Black Sea off the coast of Russia. Hundreds of passengers died as they were hurled into the icy waters. News of the disaster was further darkened when an investigation revealed the cause of the accident. It wasn't a technical problem like radar malfunction or even thick fog. The cause was human stubbornness. The captain of both the ships were aware of the other ship's presence nearby. Both could have steered clear of each other. But according to the investigation, neither captain wanted to give way to the other. Each was too proud to yield first. And by the time they came to their senses, it was too late. Most of the trouble in the world is caused by people wanting to be important. Can we say that together? Most of the trouble in the world is caused by people wanting to be important. Do we want to be important? And as we reflect on our lives, well, what has been the outcome of this kind of attitude? It is enmity not only between man and man, but between man and God. And in God, you come up against something that is in every respect immeasurably superior to you. Unless you know God as that, and therefore know yourself as nothing by comparison, you do not know God at all. You see, as long as you are proud, you cannot know God. A proud person is always looking down on things and on people. And of course, as long as you are looking down, you cannot see something that is above you. You will never be able to know God as long as you are proud. Let me end with a story, okay? A pastor, a Boy Scout, and a computer expert were three passengers on a small plane. After the plane had flown for a while, the pilot came into the cabin and told everyone that the plane was going down. And there were only three parachutes for the four people who were on board. The pilot said, "I have a wife and three small children. I must have one of the parachutes." Then he took one and jumped. The computer whiz kid said, "I should have one of the parachutes because I'm the smartest man in the world and everybody needs me." Then he took one of the packs and jumped. The pastor turned to the Boy Scout and said with a sad smile, "You are young and I have lived a rich life. So you take the remaining parachute, I'll go down with the plane." "Oh, pastor," the boy said, "relax. The smartest man in the world just picked up my backpack and jumped out." So God, I trust that this short, direct message will alert us to the seriousness of pride. Okay. What are they again? Okay, they are the
What are they again?
They're devilish, they're deceitful, and destructive. Let me close very quickly by sharing on some symptoms of pride. Okay, we will elaborate on this in the next sermon. The symptoms of pride. You know, pride is like a cancer. At first, a person is unaware of it as it grows undetected in his body. Yeah, you don't know. You know, a proud person doesn't know he's proud. And gradually, you become aware that something is not functioning the way it should. You get aches and pains, you feel nauseated, and a discoloration or a lump appears. Now, the person is faced with two choices: go to a doctor for a diagnosis and treatment, or pretend there is nothing wrong. But as time goes on, the problem becomes more difficult to conceal. The once small, seemingly insignificant growth has become a consuming and terminal illness. Pride is like that. At first, the symptoms are almost unnoticeable. You become a little impatient when inconvenienced. You start to avoid certain people you think who are below you. It takes a little longer to forgive someone who offended you. And then you find it very hard to say, "I'm sorry, you're right, and I'm wrong," when corrected. Let me share with you some symptoms from my own experience. Well, one has to do with taking credit for God's work. You know, the way I tell stories or give testimonies that tend to put myself in a better light. Yeah, I can also like hint that I'm responsible for the good things that happen. Isaiah 42 verse 8 says, "I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory I will not give to another, nor my praise to carved images." So we have to be careful even as we talk about what God has done in us and through us, that we don't, in some kind of careless way, or sometimes even intentional way, to get the glory, yeah, to show that, oh, I contributed to this. Then another symptom is being demanding. When I'm demanding, I'm constantly bringing attention to what has not been done for me. When I'm demanding, I insist that people do things my way. When I'm demanding, I'm saying I'm superior to you. And that brings me to a sense of superiority. I think I'm more important than others and start to look down on other people. I develop an attitude of condescension and begin to harbor a belief that somehow I'm better than another person. Or I'm closer to God because of my doctrines, education, wealth, actions, or intrinsic worth. Then hardness of heart. You know, as Christians, we are called to rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. But there's an old English proverb that says, when a proud man hears another being praised, he feels himself injured. Have you experienced that before? You're in a group of friends, and then one of them, maybe a colleague in your office, got praised by the boss or got promoted, and you actually feel angry. Yeah, I sometimes find myself secretly rejoicing when things are not going so well for others. And I also find it hard sometimes to encourage others to and rejoice in their blessings. I also find it hard to express affection and tenderness. So these are some of the things I've experienced that are little symptoms of pride. And by God's grace, the Holy Spirit points out these things so that I'm on a path of constant examination of myself and coming before God for forgiveness. Next week, we will continue. So I just trust that what we have shared today will be a blessing to you. So once again, the three aspects of why God hates pride. One, it is devilish. Yeah, it's satanic in its root. Secondly, it's deceptive. We lie to ourselves. We believe lies about ourselves. And then thirdly, it's destructive. It ruins everything around us, including the people we're supposed to love and care for. So let's end this time by praying together. Let's open our hearts to the Lord and let's ask the Holy Spirit to search out those roots of insecurity, those roots that can bring us into the place of pride, and bring it to the Lord. Okay, so I trust that even as we wind up this service, and you go back, as you look at the notes, when you go into your cell groups, you know, these thoughts, this sense of coming before God and humbling yourself before Him will be a kind of an ongoing exercise. I'm not asking you to be always scraping about yourself or condemning yourself. Okay, but it's always good to examine ourselves. At least once a week, have I acted in pride? Have I been behaving in such a way that people have great difficulty relating to me or great difficulty working with me? So let's pray. Okay? Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you are concerned about our character. You're concerned that we grow in wisdom, we grow in integrity, we grow in grace. So Lord, as your word says, we want to humble ourselves before you. So teach us, put your finger, Lord, Holy Spirit, put your finger into those aspects, those areas of my life, which I may not even know about, that actually is a symptom of pride in my life. Lord, give me that willingness to allow people to correct me and be willing to take time to receive those words of love and truth that I need every now and then. Thank you, Lord, that you will exalt those who are humble. So today we want to be humble before you so that you can lift us up and glorify you. In Jesus' name, everybody say, Amen.
Joy.
Thank you, Pastor, for reminding us that pride is devious. I pray that we will ask and allow the Holy Spirit to search our hearts for those four symptoms of pride so that we can deal with this cancer before it overtakes us. We've now come to the end of the online service. Thank you for joining us, and we hope to see you again. Have a blessed week ahead. Goodbye.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up His countenance on you. And be gracious unto you, the Lord lift up.